like a bit different now. Now that my heart's been found, nothing really feels the same. I hold my head a bit higher, I lift my voice a bit louder. Yeah, something inside has changed. I am a mountain mover, water walker, more than just an overcomer. 'Cause I've been set free. I am a gospel preacher, heart on fire, freedom singing, testifier. 'Cause I've been redeemed. I am a believer. I am a believer. I know this is not my home. I know I don't walk alone. No matter what comes my way, I have peace through the trouble, I have joy through the struggle. Now my hope's in a brighter day. I am a mountain mover, water walker, more than just an overcomer. 'Cause I've been set free. I am a gospel preacher, heart on fire, freedom singing, testifier. 'Cause I've been redeemed. I am a believer. Oh, I am a child.
Jesus said that if I thirst, I should come to him. No one else can satisfy, I should come to him.
Jesus said if I am weak, I should come to him. No one else can be my strength, I should come to him. For the Lord is good and faithful, he will keep us day and night. We can always run to Jesus, Jesus strong.
Quickly we forget the God who lives in every day. How easy to lose sight that you reside in the mundane. How quickly we forget the power that's running through our veins, the kind of power that empties grave. Tell me that just when I forget the voice that's holding back the waves was once the voice that told the skies to pour them into place. Let us join the endless song of everlasting praise, the only God who empties graves. Oh,
there's a reason I can sing. There's a reason for this life inside me. One name above all names, Jesus. Yes, it's Jesus. There's a reason for this hope. There's a I will lift my hands up. my final breath has left these lungs, I'll forever be with you. Where the song goes on.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us on this Labor Day long weekend. The call to worship today is from Psalm 150. Praise the Lord. Praise God in his sanctuary. Praise him in his mighty heavens. Praise him for his acts of power. Praise him for his surpassing greatness. Praise him with the sounding of the trumpet. Praise him with the harp and lyre. Praise him with timbrel and dancing. Praise him with the strings and pipe. Praise him with the clash of cymbals. Praise him with resounding cymbals. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord.
Thank you. your glory come and let your glory fall.
Dear Lord, thank you that your glory is here, that we can trust in you, that you know, we know that you'll give us what we need. But what we need most is your presence, Lord, your guidance, your love, your grace. As we go into this time of transition, Lord, into the fall, would you be with us as our schedules might get busier, as our young people go back to school, whatever that looks like, as our teachers deal with the difficulties of still living in this pandemic. Give them courage and wisdom and rest. As we focus on you, as we keep you in the center of all that we are and all that we do. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hello, class. I am Professor Eugene Racer. A.K.A. Professor E-Racer. I got that nickname because I'm pretty quick. Hoo-ha! With the eraser. Oh, excuse me. That's a lot of dust. Anyway, today we're gonna play a fun game that's gonna test your memory skills and my skills with the eraser. It's quite simple. I'll read you a Bible verse, give you a few seconds to study it, then erase something. Your job is to shout out what's missing. Easy enough, right? That's what I thought. Okay, let's get started. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Genesis 1:1. Study this verse carefully, because I'm about to erase the last word. Okay, you've got 10 seconds. Shout out the last word if you know what it is. Up. Who said earth? You're correct. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Well done. Well, let's try another verse. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. Proverbs 3:5. Everybody got it? Oh, good, because now I'm going to erase three words. Okay, you've got 10 seconds again. Shout out the missing words. Time's up. Who said all your heart? Nice job. You were paying attention. The verse says, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. All right, let's see what the next verse is. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Romans 3:23. Study this verse carefully, because I'm about to erase the book and verse number. Okay, 10 seconds on the clock. Shout out the book and verse number if you know what it is. Time's up. Who said Romans 3:23. Romans 3:23 says, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Good work, everyone. All right, it is now time for the final verse of the day. If you declare with your mouth, Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Romans 10:9. Study this verse very carefully, because I'm about to erase three words. Okay, you've got 10 seconds. Shout out the missing words if you remember what they are. Time's up. Did everyone say Jesus is Lord? If so, you're correct. Those were the three words missing from the verse which says, if you declare with your mouth, Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Well done, everyone. Your memory was put to the test today, but I give you all a passing grade. Now, if you'll excuse me, I need to get some fresh air. I think I've been breathing in just a little too much chalk dust.
Today's scripture is taken from Ephesians 4, 1 to 6. Ephesians 4, 1 to 6. As a prisoner of the Lord, then I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you have received. Be completely humble and gentle. Be patient, bearing with one another in love. Make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to one hope when you were called, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. May God add his blessing to this, the reading of his holy word.
Our Father everlasting, One church, one faith, one anthem raised. God and God alone. One cross, one grace, one name that saves. All praise to you belongs. All praise to you belongs. We lift you higher, higher. God and God alone, your name be louder, louder than any other song. You are forever seated on your throne. You are forever God and God alone. Who else can wash our sin away? God and God alone. Who else can raise us from the grave? All praise to you belongs. All praise to you belongs. We lift you high.
Well, good morning and welcome to Labor Day at Kanata Baptist Church, and it is Communion Sunday. Now, today we are going to be talking about Christian community from Ephesians 4, but I got to tell you, there's a significant disincentive going on here. I don't have to wear a mask, and the longer I preach, the longer I don't have to wear a mask. So, somebody probably has a roast in the oven. Yeah, don't start throwing things, please. I've told I'll be unplugged if I go too long, so don't worry. There is disincentive, but there's safeguards. So you'll make it in time for lunch somewhere today. So welcome. It's great to be together, isn't it? Now, until now, many of us have been enjoying a nice warm summer. Many have had vacations, and some have even tied the knot and got married. Last summer, I officiated many of these weddings. It was awesome. They were small, intimate gatherings with a lot of punch. In fact, exactly a year ago today, on Labor Day weekend, I officiated my middle daughter Bethany's marriage to Pat. Woohoo! It was during COVID, and 50 people were allowed. it felt a little weird because of the protocols, masks, and such. And maybe some were even a little bit anxious, but there was community and love, and it was incredible. And also, because it was held in Quebec, we were able to have dancing. No one lost their salvation, don't worry. I got to dance with Marquita, my daughter, the bride, and I even got to dance with my grandkids, and all during COVID. It was awesome. But, you know, as fun as that was, and as fun as weddings are, I really enjoy something about doing weddings, and that's the rehearsal. The rehearsal is incredible. This young couple in the bridal party, they're like deer in the headlights. There's an expectation, but an uneasiness, and there's a lot to go over. And for most young people, they underestimate the complexity, kind of like a service like this. There's a lot of things going on here. So I have them stand exactly where they need to be with small tape marks on the floor or grass if it's outside. We pretend to start the music, and each of the bridesmaids and groomsmen come down the aisle in appointed order. We review where the parents sit, who walks the bride down the aisle. We go over who has the rings and who has the custom-crafted vows, because we know the bride never has pockets in her dress, right? And what they're going to say to each other. The table is set up for the signatures to sign off the paperwork. Someone's got to have a pen, and don't forget the forms. We had one group lose their marriage license on their wedding day. We had to do it all over again. And then last but not least are the announcements about pictures, reception, and all this. And it's funny, especially the groomsmen usually stumble around for a while, and after about three tries, everyone gets it. It's a great time to reassure the couple that even if someone drops the flowers, or the electricity goes out, or they have to move inside because of the rain, which is what happened to my daughter, they will still end up married. And that helps settle them down. Then I say, enjoy your wedding day. It's your day. Relax and enjoy. I remind them to relax and enjoy and not forget the end goal, being married for a lifetime. Then the bonus is a great dinner with lots of fellowship after, and that's really fun. But what does all this have to do with us, you ask? Well, have you ever realized that this life, what we are experiencing right now, is actually just a rehearsal? We are learning how to act, how to work through things, how to abide with Christ, and how to live in the common hope we have. And we, like new bridal parties, stumble around a bit until we get to heaven and enjoy not the rehearsal and the rehearsal dinner, but the actual marriage supper of the Lamb. In the meanwhile, we're in some sort of wave of COVID right now. Many of you will soon be going back to the office or school, the start of fall programs, getting the kids up in the morning, normal schedules. And we've all been in various stages of isolation during this, haven't we? There's been separation and lockdown for about a year and a half. And as I'm sharing right now, many of you are logged in electronically. And a warm welcome to each one of you. I pray this service is a blessing to you wherever you're sitting at this very moment. If you're at home, I hope you have the bread and juice ready and are prepared to take communion with us virtually in a few minutes. As we've been separate for so long, our sense of community can easily be lost. Anxiety over being together can creep in, and the joy of being a community in Christ can slowly ebb away. How about you? Are you a bit fearful? Many are. Do you feel a bit disconnected from our community? Some do. Or what does community even mean during these COVID times? The Apostle Paul helps us understand how to live in Christian community in Ephesians 4. And our big idea this morning, if you don't get anything else, try and get this. Christian community is being one in heart, one in harmony, one in hope in Jesus. One in heart, one in harmony, one in hope in Jesus. Where do I get that, you ask? Well, thankfully, the scripture was read earlier by Reba, and thank you for that. And here's what it says, Ephesians 4, 1-6. As a prisoner for the Lord, then, I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you have received. Be completely humble and gentle. Be patient, bearing with one another in love. Make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. There is one body and one spirit, just as you were called to one hope when you were called, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all, through all, and in all. This is the word of the Lord. Now these are Paul's words from the Lord, written from a Roman prison. Ephesians is the first of what are called the prison epistles, or letters sent from prison. These are written to an Ephesian church that Paul spent significant time with, probably the longest of any church, 3.5 years. The book of Ephesians has 6 chapters. The first 3 describe our exalted position in Christ, and then the last 3 describe how we live our lives collectively as the body of Christ in that exalted position. So the last 3 chapters, 4, 5, and 6, are very communal and focus on our life together. And Life Together is the title of a book written by Dietrich Bonhoeffer. It's very famous, and it emphasized this type of life that Paul talks about in Ephesians 4, 5, and 6. Bonhoeffer maintained that Christianity is not a singular faith, but a faith that's lived out in community, together. He went so far as to say that Christianity really is community in Christ. This community is what the Bible calls koinonia, or the common fellowship in the Spirit of Christ. Bonhoeffer wrote this book, Life Together, in 1939, when many of his colleagues and students had already been imprisoned due to their opposition to the Nazi regime. Soon he would be imprisoned too, and then hung. So Bonhoeffer, a modern-day prisoner, speaks about life together in his book and quotes the apostolic prisoner, Paul, who penned these verses in Ephesians from prison. I'll quote Bonhoeffer's book, Life Together, several times in this message, and we'll learn about community, even during times of separation, from 2 imprisoned men who were unable to be physically with their people. So Paul, the ancient prisoner, starts chapter 4, the second half of this letter, with verse 1, and he says, "Live a life worthy of the high calling we all have received." This is the general call to all believers to follow Jesus Christ, this great and high calling paid for by the highest price, the blood of Jesus Christ himself, the call to receive by grace through faith this salvation, to become one of God's children, to walk in obedience to Jesus. This is not referring to a specific call or vocation or the works prepared in advance for us to do from Ephesians 2:10. No, this is the general call to walk in loving obedience to God and to love his people. After exhorting us to live up to this high calling in verse 1, then Paul describes how we do that together in community in the following verses. You'll remember that living in Christian community is being one in heart, harmony, and hope in Jesus. So let's look at the first of these. Christian community is being one in heart. Check out verse 2 of Ephesians 4. Be completely humble and gentle. Be patient, bearing with one another in love. This verse is so clear about being filled with God's love and keeping our emotions in check with that kind of love. Now, I must have needed some work in this area because my daughter Bethany, the same one who got married on this very day last year, painted this verse for me for my birthday 20 years ago. I'm sure the camera will somehow see this through the spit screen here, but it's very good. The canvas to me was a not so subtle hint of the type of, can you see over here? Can you see that? Perfect. Okay, you can't see my face. That's why you said it's perfect. It was a not so subtle hint. Be completely humble and gentle. Be patient, bearing with one another in love. Yes, we must bear with one another in love, not be a bear. Yet what really is this kind of love? Do we look to the world, TV, movies? We get kind of a distorted view that way, don't we? Surely our source of this kind of love must be God, and the description of this type of love must come from Jesus and his word to us. Bonhoeffer reminds us, and I quote him, What love is, only Christ tells us in his word. Contrary to all my own opinions and convictions, Jesus Christ will tell me what love toward the brethren really is. The other person needs to be loved for what he or she is, as one for whom Christ became a man, died, and rose again, for whom Christ bought forgiveness of sins and eternal life. I must meet him or her only as the person that he already is in Christ's eyes, the person they already are in Christ's eyes. So we must see people as Christ sees them. We must recognize them as a person who Christ died for, as he or she already is in Christ's eyes. They're forgiven, they're loved, they're chosen. Only then will we have the humility and the patience and gentleness to bear with them in love. Now, of course, many of you recognize these traits as fruits of the Spirit, but you may say, well, I often exhibit different kinds of fruits, and I call them more fleshly ones. So Galatians 5:16 says, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. So we can ask God to empower us by his Spirit and help us from falling into those fleshly emotions. And he promises, he said that he will give us his love. He has shed abroad his love in our hearts by this same Holy Spirit, Romans 5:5. What a hope and a promise. So one in heart, one in harmony, one in hope in Jesus. We've seen one in heart. Let's move on to the second point. Christian community is being one in harmony. Harmony. Check out verse 3 of Ephesians 4. Make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. Unity or harmony of the Spirit. It's a lofty goal. Peace and harmony for many of us feel like distant dreams, don't they? We grew up in or now live in environments that are filled with discord and division. This is where we must actually individually and personally go to the Prince of Peace. He promises in John 14:27, peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled and do not be afraid. So we ask Jesus, we go to him asking for his promised peace, and then we receive it by faith. And then there's a reminder earlier on in Ephesians in chapter 2:14. He reminds us that corporately Jesus is our peace. Verse 14 says, for he himself is our peace, who has made the two groups one and has destroyed the barrier, the dividing wall of hostility. So Jesus also makes peace. He gives us peace, but then he makes peace. He doesn't just keep the peace, like the thankless job we send our troops into where they're getting shot at and can't shoot back. No, he actually makes peace. Again, this can be received together with others by recognizing Jesus' rule and reign over us and surrendering to his peacemaking presence. We can do that collectively, surrendering to his rule. Bonhoeffer also adds that this harmony is God's idea, not some ideal we dream up. Like the communists in Russia, who had a vision for community and equality that squashed and killed every person who did not share the exact vision of what this community should look like. Stalin's vision is completely contrary to what we're talking about here. So Bonhoeffer says, the man who fashions a visionary ideal of community himself demands that it be realized by God, by others, and then he lives by it. He enters the community of Christian with his own demands, sets up his own law, acts as if he is the creator of the Christian community, as if this dream will bind people together. When things do not go his way, he becomes first an accuser of the brethren, then an accuser of God, and finally an accuser of himself. End quote. We must remember that we are, after all, kind of a motley crew of being healed people who are still in the process of being transformed into the image of Christ. We're not there yet. So harmony surely means a unity of spirit, despite our different opinions, political affiliations, or views of this world. All of these are non-essential next to the bond of peace brought about by Jesus' shed blood for each one of us. for he himself is our peace. Focusing on the essentials in Christ and giving people room to hold different opinions on other non-essential issues is the secret sauce to community harmony. As Augustine said, in essentials, unity, in non-essentials, liberty, in all things, charity. This I feel, this I desire, this I do indeed hope for in him who is our hope. One heart, one harmony, one hope in Jesus. That's Christian community. So we've seen the first two. Let's look at the third point here. Christian community is being one in hope. Look at verse 4. There's one body and one spirit, just as you were called to one hope when you were called. We collectively have this great hope through Jesus Christ our Lord. It can, during times of trial and distress, seem a little far off, can't it, when we're in the middle of stuff? How do we continue to fan this flame of hope? How do we keep the hope alive, even during lockdowns, even during COVID? Well, Paul tells us. He gives a very clear description in 1 Thessalonians 4, verses 16 to 18. He talks about the Lord himself coming down with a loud command, the voice of the archangel, trumpet call, dead in Christ rising first. After that, we who are still alive and are left will be caught up together with him in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will be with the Lord forever. Therefore, encourage one another with these words. And so we all will be with the Lord forever. And we're to encourage one another with these words. This is the most fantastic, incredible news. We will be with him together. Let's keep encouraging each other with that. You see, this hope we have is a communal hope, not just a personal hope. We will all be with the Lord forever. The whole community of faith awaits the second coming of Jesus Christ. And so Bonhoeffer says, now we belong to Christ because we are in Christ. That is why Scripture calls us the body of Christ. This means we have been chosen and accepted with the whole church in Christ. Then we will also belong to him in eternity with one another. We who live here in fellowship with him will be one day with him in eternal fellowship. He who looks upon his brother should know that he will be eternally united with him in Jesus Christ. Wow, we'll be eternally united with these brothers and sisters in Jesus Christ. Think about what Bonhoeffer is saying. We will be in eternity together with each other, like a forever family. Now think of all the annoying people you've ever met in a church somewhere. We really are a particular people. I mean, there's every kind of person and no one gets along with everyone. Yet all of these weird and wonderful folks will be with all of us, you know, the perfect ones. Those ones will be with us, the perfect ones in heaven. But it's a sobering thought. This shared hope unites us in a shared future. We're all going to be a family, and you don't get to choose your family, do you? So I've said that Christian community is being one in heart, one in harmony, one in hope. So let's wind this up. I said in the introduction that I love doing weddings and that the rehearsal is so much like what we learn in our daily lives to prepare us for heaven. Can you see that our daily COVID lives are the great rehearsal where we learn to abide with Christ and his people, our people? We also work out how things will work one day when we're all together with him in heaven. This is God's dry run for learning to live in community, one in heart, one in harmony, one in hope in Jesus. Now, if you don't believe me yet, you haven't been following with the verses or whatever, Paul gives one final reminder in Ephesians 4, verses 5 and 6, in case you missed the earlier ones. Look at verse 5 and 6. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father all, Father of all, who is over all, through all, and in all. One is repeated four times, so is all repeated four times. Paul is saying all one. All one. And finally, how would you say it? All one. Thank you. All one. Like the Trinity in the song we sang earlier, I believe that God is three in one, and we are in him, and we are one. We are the Christian community, many in God together. And the goal of this Christianity, says Bonhoeffer, is to meet one another as bringers of the message of collective salvation. The message of collective salvation. Now, today is Communion Sunday. We, the body of Christ, come together in common union, communion, with him and with each other. May God's heart for our connectedness and community be yours today, like the rehearsal and the rehearsal dinner. Thank you. Please be seated. We will now be taking communion together. If you're at home, if you could please get your elements, your bread and your juice ready. And we have cups here. If you don't have a cup, I believe there's still some on the back table. Communion at KBC is an open communion. That means all who believe in Jesus and have received him as their Lord and Savior are entitled to partake in this memorial. We come together in faith as the body of Christ, as God's own people, because of his grace and goodness, not on any merit of our own. So we have come together today in obedience to Jesus' own command to share the Lord's Supper. To these blessings and common fellowship, all true disciples of the Lord Jesus are invited to come. Now, if you have never surrendered your life to Jesus and would like to receive blessed salvation through him today, you can take the communion today as a sign of faith in his saving grace. Taking communion will be your first act of faith. Come to his table prepared for you, each one. For this isn't our table, this is the table of our Lord that he invites us to. Now for all of us, please, let's just bow our heads for a second Take a moment now and reflect on all you have been forgiven for, all the Lord has forgiven you for. As you think about this, why don't you thank God for his forgiveness in Jesus' name? Then ask God if there's anything right now that you need to repent of or confess. Is there anything separating me from fellowship with you, God? Just reflect on this. Is there anything separating me from fellowship? As you reflect, ask him to forgive you in Jesus' name. Jesus' name. Thank you. Thank you. Through the Lord Jesus Christ, our Heavenly Father is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Therefore, you are forgiven. You are cleansed of all unrighteousness and are worthy to partake of this holy meal. Holy, holy, holy are you, Lord God Almighty. Heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Therefore, as often as we eat this bread and drink of this cup, we eat the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. We proclaim his death until he comes again. Let us proclaim the mystery of our faith. Let's pray. O Lord, we recognize your loving, sovereign presence in us and amongst us. Speak to us through the serving of these elements. Let us, your people, be edified in this remembrance, and may you be glorified. Amen. All right, if you will take your little cups and your materials here, the elements. On the night which our Lord Jesus was given over to suffering and death through the betrayal of a friend, he took bread, and after he had blessed it and given thanks for it, O Lord, he gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. This is the body of our Lord Jesus Christ. Take and eat of it." Please take your cup. After the supper, he took the cup, and after he had blessed it and given thanks for it, O Lord, he said, "Drink of this, all of you. This is my body, this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for the remission of your sins and the sins of the whole world. The blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. Drink and remember the cleansing of your sins." Thank you, Lord. As Paul said to the Corinthians, I say to you, Christ, our Passover lamb, is sacrificed for us, and we have kept the feast. May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ keep you unto eternal life. And as we're in a time of reflection, maybe I offer up prayers for us and our community. Father, we lift up to you those who are shut in, those who are ill and recovering, those who have lost loved ones. Please strengthen, comfort, and heal them in Jesus' name. Father, we bring to you families and children going back to school this week. Keep them safe. Help them to learn and thrive in safety in Jesus' name. Father, help us and heal us from this new wave of COVID. Bring us godly leadership and wisdom in voting in our federal election that's coming up in Jesus' name. Father, thank you for our pastors, our administrative staff, worship teams, tech teams. Bless their work and thank you for their humble service to all of us and to you. Father, give us a witness in this community we live in to share Christ, to show your love to our neighbors, and to make a positive difference in our city. We pray for those who are poor, homeless, abused, and don't know real love. Help them and care for them out of your great compassion. We are so thankful for every spiritual blessing you have given us in Jesus Christ. Let us walk in loving obedience to all of his commands. We love you, Lord. You are so good and so great. We praise your holy name through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
God, this year we ask you to watch over our kids. We ask that as they roam the hallways of school this year, would you go before them, preparing them for trials, for tests, and for opportunities to be Jesus to those who don't know him. We know that we are strangers in this world, so help them be your ambassadors as they meet teachers and friends. Help them to cling to your word as they go about their days. And God, would you help them to learn? Help them to learn how to love others like you love us. How to be light, how to be kind, how to be a good friend. Help them learn how not to take themselves too seriously. And help them learn how to be your hands and feet. How to listen. God, help them learn how to listen to you and others. How to walk in your ways. God, help them live in peace. Fill them with your peace that passes all understanding. And how to be wise. Lord, please help our kids to make good choices this year. Protect them as they leave our homes. And as they encounter evil in this world, send your angels to keep them safe. This year, we entrust our kids to you, God, just as we always have. So God, this year, watch over our kids once again. Amen.
Thank you.
Well, it's wonderful to be together. And isn't our God merciful to show us right in His Word how we deal with these difficult times, to give us examples in Scripture of people who were imprisoned and can show us who feel separated and distant from others how to stay connected in spirit and how to live in heart and harmony and hope together. Well, the benediction I've chosen is from chapter 3 of Ephesians, the very verses just preceding Ephesians 4, 1 to 6. And Paul has this prayer for the Ephesian church, which I think is timely for us right now. I pray that out of your glorious riches he may strengthen you with power through his Spirit in our inner being, so that Christ may dwell in our hearts through faith. And I pray that each one of you, being rooted and established in love, may have power together with all the saints to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to all the measure of the fullness of God. In Jesus' name. Now go in his blessing. If you wouldn't mind taking your communion cups and putting them in the trash can when you go by the door, that would be a blessing so someone doesn't have to touch them and pick them all up. God go with you this beautiful Labor Day weekend. Amen.
Quickly we forget the God who lives in every day. How easy to lose sight that you reside in the mundane. How quickly we forget the power that's running through our veins, the kind of power that empties grave. And oh my soul, remember who you're talking to. That's the God who walks with you. And oh my soul, he knows that if he did it then, he can do it all again. His power can still raise the dead. Don't tell me that he's finished yet. Lest we not forget the voice that's holding back the waves, was once the voice that told the skies to pour them into place.